Good morning and welcome to the 15th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. Apologies have been received this morning from Faisal Chowdhury and also from Natalie Dawn. I'm pleased to say Evelyn Tweed is back attending as Natalie's substitute. Our first item of business today is a decision to take items 3 and 4 in private. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Thank you very much indeed. The next item on the agenda is on post-budget scrutiny of the 2022-23 Scottish Budget. This morning we will hear from two panels, the Scottish Fiscal Commission followed by the Scottish Women's Budget Group. We will hear first from the Scottish Fiscal Commission, and I welcome to the first panel Dame Susan Rice, DBE, the Chair, Professor Alistair Smith, a Commissioner, and Claire Murdoch, Head of Social Security and Public Funding at the Scottish Fiscal Commission. Welcome to you all this morning. I invite Dame Susan Rice to make an opening statement, and over to you, Dame Susan.
Convener and committee, good morning, and thank you for the invitation to help you with your scrutiny of the 2022 budget. We last appeared before you, I think it was 11 weeks ago in early October, to discuss the updated forecasts we had published in August. At that point, we had just started work on the budget forecasts we published earlier this month, so a bit back to back. The main headline in our August forecast, which we discussed with you in some detail, was the costing of the new adult disability payment. We now expect the total additional costs in 2026-27 to reach £567 million, a figure broadly unchanged since our discussions in October. We're conscious that the Scottish Government published regulations last week and that you may have more questions following your recent evidence session with other stakeholders. Another area you were interested in was the doubling of the Scottish child payment, which Scottish Government had committed to delivering during this Parliament, but was not costed in our August forecast. The Scottish Government have confirmed that the payment will increase to £20 in April, and we expect it to cost an additional £103 million in the upcoming budget year, 2022-23, rising to over £180 million per year from 23-24. This cost allows for potential increases in payment of both universal credit and Scottish child payment in addition to the £20 payment. Higher inflation forecasts and UK government changes to universal credit announced in their October budget also increase the costing and the underlying forecast for Scottish child payment compared to the August position. In our new forecast, we expect spending on devolved social security to rise from £3.7 billion this year to £4.1 billion in the budget year 22-23, and to reach £5.5 billion in 26-27 once the full costs of adult disability payment and Scottish child payment are included. This is nearly £1 billion more than in our budget forecast in January this year, mainly accounted for by the introduction of adult disability payment, the doubling of the Scottish child payment, and a higher inflation forecast. We highlight in our report how a significant funding gap is expected to open up between the forecast spending on social security and the devolved funding received from the UK government. This gap reaches £750 million by 24-25. This is money which has to be found from elsewhere in the Scottish budget, and that's within the context of a resource budget which is under pressure, not helped by a negative net tax position for the next 5 years. There is significant uncertainty around our forecasts, particularly for Scottish child payment in the coming budget year, where a number of changes are being made at one time, with the expansion to older children, the doubling of the payment amount, and the impact of significant changes to universal credit. Finally, I should add that our forecast closed the day before the new Omicron variant was announced by the World Health Organization. So we're now happy to take your questions.
Thank you very much indeed, Dame Susan. Can I ask both committee members and panellists if you'd like to come in at any point, either to supplement a question or indeed an answer, to type R in the chat box, and I will do my best to facilitate that. And also for colleagues on the committee, if you could please direct your questions in the first instance to Dame Susan, and she can then disseminate from there. So I turn now to colleagues' questions, and I turn first to Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, everyone. Good morning to the panel, and thank you so much for the evidence that you submitted in advance, but also the presentation you've just given. It's extremely helpful. And if it's okay, I've got a couple of questions on a similar theme. So the first question I have actually relates to the evidence you've just given, and it is specifically when you've included the higher costs for 23-24 on the Scottish Child Payment, what rate did you cost that at that time? The other questions I have are around the written evidence that you have. In the written evidence, you note that you've revised downwards for eligibility and uptake. So I'm just keen to understand a little bit more about that downward revision and what the impact or what your assumptions around eligibility and uptake have been on that. And then I have another further couple of questions, but they're on a slightly different track. Thank you.
Thank you, Susan.
Sorry. Thank you very much for the questions. In terms of the change for the upcoming budget year, just a reminder that the Scottish Child Payment originally was offered for children under six, and the age range is now raised up to children up to the age of 16. So one of the factors affecting the overall forecast amount is that we have a lot more children included in the total of those eligible, and the amount paid has in the upcoming year will be doubling from £10 to £20 per week per child. And to give you a little more detail, I wonder if I could just turn to my colleague Alistair Smith.
Thank you, Susan. Yes, the dates at which these changes that Susan has just described were introduced in our forecast are the dates announced by the Scottish Government for the doubling of the payment, the introduction of payment to eligible children being 6 and 16, and the uprating of the payment at the end in December 2022. As far as eligibility is concerned, we have assumed, and that seems to be the message of the data that we currently have, a pretty high level of uptake, close to 80% for children under six, and just a very slightly lower rate of uptake for children between 16 when they become eligible. And we've also assumed that there will be some increase in uptake, primarily because of the interaction with changing rules for universal credit, because universal credit is the main qualifying benefit for Scottish Child Payment. And the increase in the taper for universal credit changes make some changes to the incentives for families to apply for Scottish Child Payment. So we're assuming that there will be some increased eligibility, that those eligible will have increased incentive to apply for it, especially if they have children in the age of 6 to 16 who weren't previously eligible. And there may be some incentive for people eligible for universal credit who weren't applying for it to apply for it. And there are also some incentive for people to stay on universal credit if they can. They're a bit of a work disincentive right up at the top of the eligibility band. These eligibility effects are quite hard to be precise about. We're assuming a 1% increase in eligibility and a 2 percentage point increase in take up because of these incentives. But there are a lot of uncertainty about those eligibility and incentives.
I can see Claire Murdoch would like to come in at that point.
Just to go back to the very first question as well about the exact payment amount. So Susan and Alistair said we assume the payment doubles to £20, which is the government's stated policy from December, which, as Susan mentioned, is the rollout to children aged 6 to 2015. We assume the payment is £20.80 a week, and the government have basically brought forward the uprating that would have occurred in April 2023 to December 2022. So that's just to confirm those payment amounts as well.
That's very helpful. Thank you to you both. Dame Susan, did you have anything further to add?
No, I think that's enough for that one, unless Pam would like more information.
Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for your responses. That was indeed very helpful. I have a further question around some of the assumptions as well, and this time it's around the unemployment figures. And you've assumed you now have amended that to be 4.9%. How much of the employment is are you able to talk about in terms of secure work? Do the figures break down so that you can have a look at how specific groups are affected? So, for example, women, Black minority ethnic people, or disabled people, and so on. And how would those things affect the forecast? And then I have one last question in this area.
Dame Susan.
So I don't think we have absolute detail on how it breaks down, but we do look at age populations within Scotland, and for instance, younger working people who will typically have been more involved possibly in leisure and hospitality sectors, which have been particularly constrained over the 2 years of the pandemic. We're assuming that that employment will be lower in that group. So we look at it that way. We also look at the fact of the changing demographic in the population, where we're seeing heavier growth in people in the older age levels, and those are individuals who are less likely to be in employment. So those are some general comments, and I would again turn to my colleague Alistair Smith, who I think can give you a bit more detail.
No, Susan, I have nothing to add. You've covered all the points I would have made.
Thank you. Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you very much. And my final question, thanks again for your answers, is given the forecasting what and the spending that you set out both in your written evidence but also this morning, what does that suggest for the affordability of the social security budget in Scotland in the longer term?
Dame Susan.
I think I could answer that best simply by repeating the message that you will have heard in early October, as well as now, that Social Security will cost the government here a good bit more than the funds that might be coming over from the UK government. And that is a decision to make these benefits more widely available and to, in some cases, make them easier to access. And the job there is then for the government, and I assume for the parliament, as well, to find ways to cover those extra costs. And that means just looking at priorities and where in the budget money might or might not be spent for other things to balance that out.
Thank you very much indeed, Dame Susan. Just before I bring in Jeremy Balfour next, I think we'll cover points that you've raised there around the cost pressures, the fiscal framework, the costs of adult disability payment, which is the real driver there behind the increased cost to the Scottish Government of Social Security. But I wanted to take you back very briefly to the question that Pam Duncan-Glancy asked there around employment. And I wonder what your expectation is around the Omicron variant, whether that, how much of an impact that is going to have on employment levels and therefore social security levels in the coming months. Have you any view on that to update on your previous forecasts?
It's a very good question to ask. As I pointed out, this became known to us the day after we closed down our economy forecast a few weeks back. But we have considered, and we obviously have watched closely the impact of COVID throughout. What we have assumed at this stage is that the Omicron virus is a downside risk to our central forecast, but our assumptions in our central forecast don't actually change at this stage. We had put into those assumptions some ups and downs in relation to the ongoing pandemic. We had considered some of the factors that would come with an increase over the winter. We also had observed the ability of businesses all around to come through what we had last year in the year, or the earlier this year and the year before, a little bit better than everyone had first thought. So we see Omicron as something to keep a close eye on, but not changing our central economic forecast just now. But once again, I think Alistair might give you a more nuanced response to that question.
Just to add to that, it is worth emphasizing that the social security budget as a whole is not very sensitive to unemployment or to economic conditions. It might well be that Omicron is going to have an effect on employment, especially as Susan said earlier, in the leisure and hospitality sector. But the social security budget is driven by disability benefits, which are long-term entitlements, not much affected by the economic circumstances of the recipients, and also by benefits which are tied to universal credit, and universal credit is available to families of lower income, both in and out of work. So again, even universal credit is not very sensitive to employment levels, and therefore there might be, if Omicron turns out badly, let's hope that it doesn't, and there are some positive signs, there may be some effects, some significant effects on the economy at large, but there aren't going to be there are very unlikely to be big effects on our social security projections. Plus, with whatever the Omicron effects are likely to be, they're going to be in this year or next year, and they're hopefully not going to have much effect on our long run forecasts, which is has been the highlight of this report.
Thank you very much indeed, Professor Smith. That's very helpful. And I'll bring in Jeremy Balfour, please.
Good morning, convener. Good morning, panel. And can I also thank you for your submissions and your paper? I wonder if I can ask two questions around the adult disability payment, one kind of fairly short term and one longer term. The short-term one is, and again, I think I've asked this before, and I'm still not sure I fully understand the answer, so I apologise for my ignorance. In regard to the adult disability payment, you have seen, put an increase forecast for the budget in the next couple of years because you think uptake will be higher. I just wonder again, how are you working that out in regard to uptake will be higher with the regulations coming forward? It looks like the way that the benefit will be assessed is almost identical to at the moment. So again, I'm just wondering, have you looked at that afresh with these new regulations, and is that making any difference?
Dame Susan.
Thank you. I'll begin, but again, turn to Alistair, because it's good to hear from both of us. I think the place to start is really by the motivation, if you see what I mean. The Scottish Government has expressed an aim to increase take-up and increase the number of people receiving the payment, and they have a number of levers or a number of ways to try to do that, one of which is around promotion and encouragement to apply, one of which is around helping to shape the application process to make it somewhat more accessible, a little more supportive, a little easier for applicants. But there are a number of other elements that would lead to our judgment that there will be more take up. And Alistair, if I can turn to you, do you want to fill in some of those others?
Thanks. Yes, Mr. Balfour, you're right that the formal rules of eligibility have not changed. However, as Susan has said, the Scottish Government has announced various ways in which it wants to make the whole process friendlier towards people who might be entitled to benefits, to encourage them to apply and to encourage take up of the benefits. And Mr. Balfour, if I may, I think you can be excused for feeling that you might not have understood the full effects, because they are terribly complicated. We've looked at six or seven channels through which the ADP being administered by the Scottish Government might lead to higher expenditure. For example, we expect that people who had previously applied for personal independence payment but whose applications had been turned down might have another go at applying under the new system. So we're expecting a spike, perhaps more properly, a bulge in applicants after the ADP comes in, and some of those applicants will be successful. I'm now trying to think my way through all the complications. Well, we've looked at what has happened when other changes in social security systems have been brought in, the switch from DLA to PIP, for example, and past changes have had the effect that as people get reassessed under a new system, that more people become eligible for payments, so there's an increase. And those are two of the main ways that we think there will be an increase in expenditure. But the main thing, as Susan said, is it's the Scottish Government's policy push to make the system more friendly to applicants and push up take-up rate in that way.
Thank you very much. Jeremy Balfour, please.
Thank you, Camino, and thank you for that answer. The second one is a kind of longer term one. There is going to be, the government, Scottish Government announced, a review of the criteria for getting adult disability payment, and that may or may not be implemented in this parliament, depending on time and what they are asking for from the independent commission. I wonder how much notice do you require to be able to forecast if there was a differential? So, for example, if mobility criteria was increased from 20 to 50 metres, obviously more people would be able to get that benefit. Would you be able to forecast that? And what information would you require both from DWP and from the agency to be able to do that work?
Dame Susan.
Yes, so that is it's a very good question, and I wonder if I could turn to Claire, who I know will have her arms around all of that detail, to give you the response.
I think the short answer is we will produce a forecast when the government has a policy. So we always stand ready for the government introducing these changes. If they were to have a review, we would obviously have notice of that review. And then once the government had decided the policy, we would include it in our forecast to make sure that that was available to Parliament before you considered any regulations changing the rules. In terms of the information that we need, I suppose we've said this multiple times in this adult disability payment sort of forecast that we're having to make a lot of judgments here, that there is information on how the current system works, but nobody knows exactly how the new system will work. And I think that to a certain extent, when the policy is changed here, we will be in a similar position, that nobody will know exactly what the effects of those changes are. But we can look at people who currently qualify, and we can also look at sort of when you apply for PIP at the moment, you obviously score points under these different criteria, and we can look at how many people are receiving those points or not receiving those points, and then try and assess how that might be different if the rule was changed. So we would be looking for DWP and Social Security Scotland as well to collect that information, hold it in a way that we could use it to produce our forecast. So I hope that answers your question, but happy to elaborate further.
Jeremy Balfour.
If Parliament were minded to alter the regulations that we have at the moment, how quickly can you do that piece of work?
Dame Susan?
Just to repeat what Claire said, what we don't do by our framework, if you will, is to cost potential or possible changes. But as soon as there is a policy that has been announced, we'll go in and cost it. And if we have some advance warning, it's hard for me to put a number of days or weeks, but you know, we will be anticipating what that might be. Claire, you're closer to the actual team who do the modeling and do the work. Can we put a time frame on that once the policy is announced?
I sort of want to say anything is possible. The longer we have, the more we can look at something in detail, and the better, the more confidence that we can have in our estimate, and the shorter amount of time that we have, I suppose, the sort of the greater uncertainty. So sort of the ambitious part of me would say a couple of weeks, a month, and my team are probably currently sat there saying, say it's a bit longer than we need. We're talking about, you know, we do the whole budget process in 10 weeks, and the government are free to announce policy in that time and change it. We work in a similar timescale if required.
Your flexibility and ambition on behalf of all of us is admirable, and we appreciate that. Jeremy Balfour, have you got a further question? Thank you very much. Pam Duncan-Glancy had a brief supplementary here before I bring in Miles Briggs.
Thank you. And just also to say, to echo the conveners, thanks and appreciation for your flex on work like this. Very briefly, in your estimates for adult disability payment going forward, have you made any estimate about how many people how many people's awards would increase, decrease, or stay the same? And if so, what are your assumptions around those three areas?
Dame Susan.
Could I again turn to one of my colleagues who will have what we do know in terms of the assumptions. Claire, are you able to, or Alistair, actually, maybe you'll have that at your fingertips.
Well, I'm not sure about my fingertips, Susan, but our forecasts, Ms. Duncan-Glancy, don't quite go into numbers increased and numbers decreased. We our forecasts focus on what's the overall number increased, and we are forecasting that the introduction of ADP will increase the number of people who are receiving this benefit. But I'm tempted to go a little bit further and say we don't see any forces suggesting that there'll be a substantial number of people who would have been eligible for, who would have received a benefit under PIP and will not receive one under ADP. But you know, the assessment process is you know, however friendly it is to applicants, one can't guarantee that there wouldn't be some people who would have succeeded in application under PIP who won't under ADP. But overall, the pressure is entirely in the other direction, that there will be more recipients under ADP than under PIP. The short answer to your question is we haven't broken it down in the way that you've asked.
I just wonder if Claire has a supplementary comment to that.
Yes, as I was to say, I'm not sure we do it in quite the way that you're suggesting, but what I can say is that we have considered what effect we think we will see for people who are new applicants, and also what will happen when people go through the award review process. So for new applicants, we assume that 25% of clients who would have received a nil award under PIP will now receive a standard award under ADP, and that 15% who would have received a standard award under PIP will now receive an enhanced award under ADP. So we assume some people receive a slightly higher award than they would have done before under the PIP system. And then once people are in the review process, at the moment, about 19% of clients under PIP will be a disallowed at review, and we assume that will fall to 5%, partly because of just the way the award review process is changing, so that people are not automatically disallowed if they don't respond to a letter, so that it's a more collaborative approach to the review process. And then obviously that then has an effect on how many people stay on the payment and how many people have an increase or decrease at award review as well. Hopefully that answers the question.
Yeah, no, that's very helpful and interesting. So just to be clear, Claire, are you assuming that the assessment process for ADP is going to be more accurate and therefore result in fewer reviews going forward?
It's not that, so the reviews will still take place because their awards will have a set amount of time. It's more the appeals process that we assume will be slightly different. So fewer people will have to go to an appeal to then not have their award disallowed. So at the moment, quite a lot of people are disallowed and then they appeal it and then they are successful at appeal. So we assume that some of that applies earlier in the system.
Thank you very much indeed. Miles Briggs, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us today. I wanted to ask two questions with regards to the forecasting which has been put forward. Specifically, you've outlined an estimated £1 billion in additional expenditure. So I wanted to ask, from your experience, what steps are ministers taking to look at how they'll control those pressures in the future going forward?
Dame Susan.
So we don't assess exactly what you're asking. So we don't assess what steps ministers might be taking, but what we do is highlight the fact that consideration will need to be taken in terms of the disparity between the amount of money that will be required to deliver the Social Security benefits and the amount of money that may be coming in to be available for those benefits. But and so we simply highlight that. We do that in our report. We've done it in the media release to the report. We've done it here at this committee today and previously. But it is up to ministers to consider how they fund the Social Security payments that are promised and are available in the way they want them to be by looking at the entire budget. So we don't assess that. Sorry not to give you a fuller answer possibly, but
Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Kamina. No, that's okay. And I suppose I was approaching this question from the fact that we have such a new system with Social Security Scotland and making sure that we do actually and make that affordable system, but that resources are being monitored, that costs are being properly maintained. So I suppose turning that question on its head, what learnings do you think ministers will have to soon have around how best to actually to meet that? And, you know, given this significant, when you look at the overall Scottish Parliament budget, significant additional money we'll have to find, where would you think that would come from?
Dame Susan.
I just want to come in to tell you where. I would, again, refrain from giving that answer, mainly because that begins to get us closer to a sort of policy area, and our job isn't to assess or comment on policy. It's to look at the cost of that for the budget. You asked what lessons would be learned. Let me take that question and perhaps turn it slightly on its head. Often lessons learned come after the fact or after a problem. I think what you have here is a government and hopefully a parliament fully that understand that there is a challenge ahead in order to meet the costs of the Social Security program, and that they are looking ahead against the legal requirement that you have to have a balanced budget each year, looking ahead to see where those monies will come from, or where, you know, what are the priorities? Because there are lots of things that the budget will propose to spend money on, and so it needs to spend a little less in one place in order to spend a little more. So lesson learned, but it's possibly lessons along the way, because I think that issue is on the table and anticipated now. I just can't tell you how we think ministers will or indeed ought to address that.
Thank you. Miles Briggs.
Thank you for that. And just finally, I wanted to ask, in terms of your experience of, you know, not just this budget, but across the whole portfolio of policies we have in the Parliament, what would you like to see, and specifically for this committee around social security, to improve the processes which we actually have in place to follow resources? I think from my time on the Health and Sport Committee, whenever we did budget scrutiny, it was incredibly difficult to follow a taxpayer pound through the NHS. So I just wondered from your experience if there's any learnings which you'd like to put on record around that.
Dame Susan.
Could I turn to Alistair or Claire if you have a way to respond to that?
Professor Smith, shaking your head.
No, I don't think I have any wisdom to offer Mr. Briggs on that specific question. But to on the earlier issue of lessons to be learned, like Susan, it's, you know, I'm not going to start advising ministers on how they should answer the quite proper questions you've raised. But there is one important lesson from our analysis, which is that when we're looking at the social security budget, we're looking not just at a large sum of money, but we're looking at long-term commitments. Once people become eligible, for example, for adult disability payment, they're likely to remain eligible for a long period of time. It's not open to the government to control the budget by rationing access to it. Access is determined by the criteria, and perhaps the most important lesson for ministers about the budget is that commitments that are entered into are for the long run and need to be considered in a long-term way, which is the reason why we've put so much emphasis in our current report on these long-run forecasts.
Thank you very much indeed. Does that conclude your questions?
Yes, thanks. Thanks,
next question, please. Thank you. From Evelyn Tweed, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Does the Scottish Fiscal Commission expect the £20 Scottish child payment to make a big difference to the people applying?
Dame Susan.
Again, you're asking for possibly a judgment, which is a non-forecasting judgment here. One has to assume that you know, more money available, if used in the right way, should make a difference. I mean, it's just that there's a logic in that. But where we have considered the impact of that doubling of the amount is that we think it may attract possibly more people who are already eligible to go and apply for the benefit, because it appears to them to be more worthwhile. So when we look at the doubling, that's the way we look at it. Will it have an impact on eligibility, which is one of our key factors in doing our forecasts on the Social Security benefits? Claire, anything else to say about that?
I suppose just to say that in combination, where we think there will be a response from people applying, because obviously if the money is available and people are eligible, then they should be claiming it. So we think that there will be around 15,000 extra children applying because of the higher payment. And that's a combination because of people, as Susan has said, taking it up or also becoming eligible.
Thank you very much indeed. That's helpful to know. Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, convener. And what are your views on the fiscal framework and how it works or doesn't work for Scotland?
Dame Susan.
And an indeed important question to raise. The fiscal framework, as had been planned from the beginning, is due to be reviewed in 2022. So very, you know, shortly, there will be that review. That review will take place between the Scottish government and the UK government. So the Fiscal Commission will not be directly involved in the review. If we were, that might be a little bit like marking one's own homework to some extent. But if there are changes to the fiscal framework, when they are agreed and announced, what we will definitely do is take a look at those and try to explain through an occasional paper or reports or whatever what the impact of those changes might be. So I hold back from actually giving an opinion of what we think about that, because it really is not just outside our purview, but I think it would be inappropriate for us to, you know, to share views, particularly at this stage. It hasn't even begun, but it is a matter for discussion and debate between the two governments.
Thank you. Evelyn, do you have a further question before I bring in Marie McNair?
No, that's me, convener. Thank you.
Thank you. Marie McNair, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Dame Susan, you estimated that the cost of adult disability payment will be higher than PIP by some margin. How much of this is due to a more compassionate approach by promoting take-up and dealing with claims?
Dame Susan.
Yes, so again, there are a number of factors, and you're right. The Social Security Scotland has in its sort of primary vision wanting to increase take-up or increase availability of these benefits to more people who are eligible and who want them. So that's their stated objective. And in order to do that, they're applying several factors, some of which we mentioned before, related to ADP. And it's believed that the combination of those factors will lead to more people being involved. So it is around promotion and encouraging people, making the application process easier, if you will, or more accessible for people. I think there's a removal of face-to-face physical assessments, which may make it just easier for people who can't come out and do face-to-face assessments all that easily. There's also a lengthening of the time between award reviews. So this is an award that is for the long term, as has been pointed out by my colleagues. But obviously it needs to be reviewed to see if circumstances have changed for the individual. By lengthening the time between the award reviews, it may seem or it may feel more worthwhile for an individual to go through the application process. And there have been some changes to the definition of terminal illness. So a number of these, would serve to open up and make the payments feel more likely and more accessible to potential applicants for it.
Thank you. Marie McNair.
Thank you. You're predicting that an increase in people motivated to claim AWP will see an increase in claims for carers allowance and carers allowance supplement. Is this broadly a direct correlation between two or more? Or do you think that the memories of the barriers to claiming carers allowance will still deter some to a certain extent?
Dame Susan.
Another good question. Could I put me on mute because of the phone and turn to Claire?
Thank you, Susan. Yes, that's right. We assume that there will be an increase in carers allowance spending, and the basis for that estimate is the sort of, I suppose, current ratio that we see between the number of claims you have for PIP and the number of people receiving carers allowance. So we're assuming it's a sort of very similar situation. We have not yet included any Scottish replacement or the new Scottish carers assistance in our forecast, because the government haven't yet publish the sort of firm plans of those changes. So it's based on the existing system and the existing sort of ratios that we see between PIP and carers allowance.
Thank you, Claire. Marie McNair, do you have a further question before I bring in Jeremy Balfour, who'd indicated he had some questions in this area?
Not for this team, Chair. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Jeremy Balfour, do you have any further questions?
No, Camille, I think everything has now been covered by the other members.
Lovely. Thank you very much indeed. If there are no further questions for the panel, and nobody has indicated in the chat box that they wish to come in, I don't know if colleagues on the panel have anything further that they would wish to add, Dame Susan.
You've asked some very pertinent questions, and we'll just wish you good luck with your deliberations.
Thank you very much. And in the meantime, I wish you all a very Merry Christmas, and thank you very much for your time this morning. It's been very helpful and insightful for us doing our work. Very much appreciate your time this morning, and as I say, wish you all a very safe, merry Christmas, and all the best for 2022 as well. I will briefly suspend while we switch over from panel one to panel two. Thank you. Thank you very much indeed. Welcome back. We will now hear from our second panel. So I welcome Sarah Cowan, who is the coordinator of Scottish Women's Budget Group. Good morning, Sarah, and welcome to the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. Very much appreciate your time this morning. Again, I ask both yourself and committee members to please type R in the chat function if you would like to come in either with a supplementary question or answer. It would be greatly appreciated. And I return to inviting colleagues to ask their questions in turn, and start again with Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, and good morning, Sarah. Thank you very much for the information you've given us in advance of today, and also for coming along. I have a few questions around particularly social care and also women's responsibilities for work, including unpaid work. As was identified as a risk in the budget, women's responsibilities for paid and unpaid work particularly was considered a risk. Do you think the budget goes far enough, particularly in terms of social care, and has enough support to lift women out of poverty at this time on the basis of that? And also, do you think that it does enough to address the increased structural inequality that was seen as a risk as a result of this, and also to disabled people and women as well? Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Sarah Cowan, please.
Thank you, and thanks to the committee for inviting the Scottish Women's Budget Group to give evidence today. I'll take that question in a couple of parts. Thank you, Pam. I think we saw in the budget some elements to move towards challenging some of the structural inequalities that exist in social care, exist for women with some more investment in social care, and elements like the increase in the minimum wage floor for social care staff, who the vast majority of whom are women, are important steps, but these really have to be viewed as first steps. There's been years of underfunding and undervaluation of social care overall, and those who work within social care, as well as unpaid carers. And really, there's going to need to be huge amounts of investment to return and bring the correct level of value to that sector. I think what, as was kind of indicated in the question, if we focus on unpaid carers, there wasn't very much in the budget for unpaid carers, to be honest. There was a commitment of £5 million to provide the rights to respite for unpaid carers, but that's unlikely to go far enough, with so many unpaid carers having experienced little opportunity to take any kind of break over the course of the pandemic, with many respite services closed, at least in the first parts of the pandemic, and other fears and concerns about how to be able to access services as the pandemic continues. We also didn't see much in the way of increase in the remit of carers allowance and carers allowance support. So we would like to see that kind of benefit going further to support unpaid carers and protect unpaid carers from poverty, to increase the value of that payment, but also crucially the eligibility to carers allowance, to provide the support that's needed to protect carers. And also, I think what is needed is ensuring that the services are there to support unpaid carers in the work that they do. So the reopening of services at local levels, respite services, is going to be crucial over the next period. And as we are looking at, with uncertainty with the impact of Omicron, there's a continued kind of uncertainty about how that will come across. So So I think more could be done in answer to the top of the question to support unpaid carers. And as I say, the long-term kind of undervaluing of social care needs to be, continued support needs to be taken to ensure that's rectified.
Thank you, Sarah. Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, convener, and thank you for that, Sarah. That was really helpful. On a similar track, I was really interested to read in the submission the link that you make between social care and the climate and green jobs, and the fact that you ultimately consider, I think, social care effectively as a way to create green jobs. And it's something that I believe absolutely passionately, and I've often said that there is a key sector here that could be a massive help to our economy, particularly as we move forward to a green economy. Do you say a little bit more about how you believe the government could combine the agenda of addressing some of the financial and recruitment issues in social care at the same time as also looking at the broader climate justice solutions as well?
Thank you. Sarah Cowan.
What's crucial as we consider just transition is that we look at that as a feminist just transition, so that we're able to move towards a net zero economy that really can tackle inequalities. That means, so what we heard within a lot of the announcements on the just transition and net zero commitments were commitments to decarbonising activities, to support lived environments and make changes within industry. And what's important, as you've indicated from the note, is that we expand this view of what we need within a just transition and what would bring that to be a feminist just transition. There's a real risk that just transition could at best just maintain existing labour market inequalities that we have, where we have an energy sector that is often highly paid, male-dominated sector, and move that sector into a decarbonised energy sector that again remains highly paid but male dominated. So finding access routes to challenge the labour market inequality there, to look for opportunities for women and other and marginalised groups to get into this sector. And there's opportunities for that sort of thing within the Green Jobs Fund. But expanding what we think of as the just transition is also a crucial part of this. And so expanding what we think of as infrastructure investment, and including within thinking about infrastructure of investment, thinking about social infrastructure. And that means infrastructure in within the care economy as part of an important investment, and not just not a cost to the economy, but investing in social care as a move towards a green economy will bring returns for both economy and society. And so if we view care jobs as also green jobs and other jobs that are low carbon impact but high social good as part of this move to green jobs, and try and link up the thinking that's going on with the establishment of the National Care Service and the move to just transition, that's a really important element of seeing how this economy can work better for women.
Thank you, Sarah. Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you. That was really helpful. I have no further questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Before I bring in Evelyn Tweed, I just wanted to bring you back to the points that were being made there around unpaid carers and the support available to them. To what extent do you think that the £5 million will help in terms of respite for unpaid carers? You've said that it's not enough, but could you quantify how supportive that will be, and how much more you think would have been needed in order to help fill up what has clearly been a very challenging time for unpaid carers through the pandemic?
It is really challenging to quantify that. I think it's looking at the fact that we see from surveys conducted by Carers Scotland that so many, as I mentioned, so many unpaid carers have been unable to take any respite, either because of closures or because of health concerns. But that means there's been a pent up need. So there's likely to be a need for a kind of a period where more respite than usual will be needed because there's been this lack of access. And then at an ongoing level, continuing to ensure that respite is available. I think in addition to that, we need to recognise that there's now a lot more unpaid carers than there was before the pandemic. So we need to look at pre-pandemic levels of respite and assume that it's going to be a higher level than that due to the kind of increase in unpaid care that's been taking place. But sorry, I'm unable to quantify what the level of need, but I could look into that and see if there's and get that information back to you.
Yeah, I think that would be really helpful, because I think we all understand and appreciate the difficulties that carers have been going through during the pandemic. We've previously taken evidence on that as we took the Carers Allowance Supplement Bill through this committee and supported it through Parliament. And absolutely take your points around the fact that there are a larger number of unpaid carers that have emerged during the pandemic as well. That point appears to have been recognised by the Scottish Government, but to what extent it's going to meet demand, I think, is where we would be interested in finding out more. So any supplementary information that you have there, Sarah, would be very gratefully received. I can see Miles Briggs is looking to come in at that point. Miles.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, it was just to follow on from some of those questions. It's maybe something which you can't answer necessarily today, Sarah, but I'd be interested to know, have you seen any data around different councils, for example, which have suspended care packages? I know here in Edinburgh we've seen a lot of pressure from that during the pandemic, and not the restoring of those care packages. So I wondered if you had any examples of that, which has obviously forced more people to end up sometimes leaving their work to take up that full-time unpaid care role.
Sarah Cowan.
Thank you. That is, again, something I can come back to with more detail after after today. I think at the start or in last year, with at the start of the pandemic, the Glasgow Disability Alliance did some really good research into the suspension of care services and the impact that was having for people. So there's a report called Supercharged from them that I would also encourage members to read if you haven't already. But the second element around restoring care packages is something that for data levels, I can get back to you. What I would say is that we hear from unpaid carers within our membership a lot of frustration about the challenges and the ongoing challenges in accessing both social care support and also some health support with the ongoing impact of the pandemic, and that, you know, we've all got used to things being different and maybe more processes and steps of being able to access different kinds of services, but that's added to their existing unpaid work is moving through these new and different steps. And we hear frustration about the impact that that's having on them, while there remains what feels to them anyway like a lack of ongoing support. So the wider investment within social care is also really crucial for unpaid carers, because as services are invested in, there can be more support there, but that will be a longer term process. So some kind of supports that can help people in the short term as well, after so long within the pandemic, is what's being called for.
Thank you, Sarah. Before I bring in Evelyn Tweed, just going back again to the carers allowance supplement. Obviously, women sadly continue to bear the greatest responsibility in providing unpaid care. To what extent has that been supported by the doubling of the carers allowance supplement this month? Have you seen that impact on the ground? Is that something that has been beneficial? Is it something that you would like to see reviewed going forward?
It's probably too early to say kind of where the impact is on that. I was just checking. We do know that women make up the majority of the claimants for carers allowance and the carers allowance supplement. I think it's 69% of claimants. So any changes to that allowance will have a disproportionate impact for women, and are really important changes to make. I think for wider, longer term reviews, what needs to be considered is how we can ensure that there is a minimum income standard for people in receipt of that benefit, and to ensure that the allowance and supplements to it can really protect carers from poverty, because we do see carers living in poverty because of the circumstances they're around in. So any future review focusing on that element and ensuring that there is that minimum income standard would be great.
Thank you very much. Evelyn Tweed, with your set of questions, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Sarah. Nice to see you here today, and thank you for your submission so far. I have a more general question, Sarah, and it's to get your views around budget decisions and what you feel will have the greatest impact on reducing inequality and promoting social justice.
Sarah Cowan.
I think what is crucial, and hopefully you'll have seen from the advance submission we made, is that in any budget decision, they are made based on information and analysis around how to tackle inequality. And for us, that means integrating intersectional gender budget analysis into the budgetary process and into this kind of review process between draft budget and finalised budget as well. And that process is crucial to ensuring that decisions that are made will work towards building a more equal society. There's the principal aim of gender budgeting is to integrate that intersectional gender analysis into economic policy, and through this process raise awareness of the different impacts that decisions will have on women and men and different groups of within women, of publicly funded policies and programmes and challenging the assumption that budget decisions can be gender blind. I think we saw in this budget some really positive decisions, especially with the kind of the big announcements around Scottish Child Payment, which will have a significant impact for women as well. So child poverty and women's poverty are intertwined, and the majority of those in receipt of Scottish Child Payment are also women. The statistics from Social Security Scotland showing that 80% of those in receipt of Scottish Child Payment are women. So those kinds of decisions will have really important impacts on the people who are in receipt of them. And for us, kind of coming back to the first set of questions, for us, where you place and the value you place on care is also really crucial for how we build an economy that creates more fairness within it and works towards equality. So the value and the investment in the care and caring economy is a really important element of how we reduce inequalities as well.
Thank you. Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Convener. And Sarah, do you think that these budget decisions and how they play out can be quantified?
Sarah Cowan.
Yes. What's important is the data that we have around the budget decisions. So ensuring that there's disaggregated data available for us to look at and analyse how the decisions are impacting on people's lives. But beyond that, to also have more intersectional data, and I think that can be where there is a real gap, is understanding how decisions impact on people differently and different people's different lived realities, and recognising that many people will have a variety of characteristics that we don't necessarily have data on to be able to get as much information as we could for that quantification of how the impacts are happening. So the more data that we can gather and the more we can bring in the intersectional nature of that data, the better analysis can be done that can then quantify the impact of the budget decisions.
Thank you. Evelyn Tweed.
That's me for now, Convener. Thank you. Thanks, Sarah.
Thank you very much indeed. I'd like to bring in Marie McNair, please, for her set of questions. And once again, remind colleagues that if anybody wishes to come in at any stage, please type R in the chat function. Thank you. Marie McNair.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Sarah. Is there any current spending in the budget you think should be transferred into areas where you want more money spent on? Sorry.
Sarah Cowan.
An area we would often encourage being re-looked at would be the consideration around capital investment and what's often termed hard hat projects, to consider how that investment is going to impact the economy and where, if that investment is having the strongest impact it can have for people of Scotland. So I think looking in those at that area is one option. But it's also about, as I was kind of highlighting it when we were discussing the just transition piece, it's also about considering how things can seem like a starting area with just transition, and often focusing on the infrastructure type projects can actually be broader than that, and the bringing together of areas so that there's better integration within the decision making.
Thank you. Marie McNair, please.
Thank you, Kavina. What do you think should take centre stage from what is proposed at a time of ever emerging COVID pressures on the budget?
Sarah Cowan.
I think if it hasn't come across already, I think care needs to be centre stage, and all forms of care. So I've talked more about social care and the importance of social care, both to people, but also the importance it can have to our economy. I think often when care is talked about, it's talked about as a cost to the economy, but it is important to see that it's an investment. It brings both economic returns and social returns in how that is invested. But also childcare and investment in childcare. So it's important that the Scottish Government is continuing investment in the expansion of childcare, and we welcome the announcements around expanding that to 2-year-olds from low-income families. The faster that rollout to reaching more children can take place is really important, and will be important towards reaching the child poverty targets as well.
Thank you. Marie McNair.
Thank you, Kavita. That's all from me just now.
Thank you. Before I bring in Pam Duncan-Glancy, you touched there on child poverty targets, Sarah, which are a key theme for the early work of this committee, particularly in terms of scrutinising the Scottish Government's budget. Because you've already mentioned in your submission and you've said here this morning how intrinsically linked women and child poverty rates are, also the fact that single parents most likely to be women, and a women's work most likely to be in part-time or low-income roles. To what extent have the changes to universal credit, that's the investment in work allowances, which obviously very welcome, but also the £20 per week cut to the standard allowance, to what extent are those changes having an impact, or do you expect, on child poverty rates in Scotland?
I mean, what's important is about being able to support people's incomes. So cutting benefits is obviously doing the exact opposite of that. And we expect to see that having an impact on women and child poverty rates. There's modelling conducted by others that demonstrates where they expect to see that the impact happening, and the rise in poverty because of the cut to universal credit. We know from previous longer term analysis that when benefits are cut and frozen, the impact of that, and so the impact of kind of austerity measures on budgets, on benefits, had a greater impact on women, and on particularly on women from ethnic minority communities and disabled women. So any change to the benefit system is likely to have a disproportionate impact on women, and the cut to universal credit I don't see as it being any different.
Thank you very much. I'd like to bring in Pam Duncan-Glancy, followed by Jeremy Balfour, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Convener, and thanks for allowing me to come in again. There's a couple of areas I just wanted to explore a wee bit further, if that's okay. My first is around in your submission you talk about the evidence that was given alongside the budget of the impact on inequalities, and that the top line information was given across portfolio areas, but we probably need a bit more detail in terms of the specific inequalities. Do you make some, or give us some idea of how that could be improved so that we can continue to improve in this area going forward? And then I have one other question on a slightly different topic, if I can come back in after.
Thank you, of course. Sarah Cowan, please.
I think to premise what I'm about to say, the Equality and Fair Scotland budget statement is a really important statement of intent that we have coming out of the alongside the budget. And it's really important to see that commitment to equalities through that publication. However, as you've mentioned, it is very top line in what was published this year. What's important to consider is that the statement is the final product of the analysis that's gone into the budget, and it can only ever be as good as this analysis. So the focus, a lot of the focus has to be on improving the quality of the analysis and assessment processes to achieve improved policy outcomes in people's lives, which can then be reported through the EFSBS. rather than it potentially being some retrospective reporting fitting inequalities and budget policies. I think maybe it's best to take an example of where there could be improvements. So within the transport portfolio, in the annex to the statement, there is a really good analysis of how public transport affects men and women differently, and spend in public transport affects men and women differently, with more women using bus services, but that the bus services are often designed in such a way that they actually work for people who are working full time, 9 to 5, going from outside town into city centres. So the analysis recognises both the importance of bus services for women, but also that the current services aren't working. Yet in how it's dealing with that inequality, the only mention is on that the ongoing subsidies to bus transport will have an improved impact on women. It would be good in that circumstance to see more detail about how the bus subsidy can help to bring more services that do work for women, that recognise more the part-time work, the kind of cross-town journeys that women are more likely to take due to caring responsibilities. So more detail like that on how the budget, how that budget allocation is really tackling the inequality that they've identified there. Without that information, then you assume there isn't any other pieces going alongside it. I think other information that could be provided to help transparency around the decision making is that there could be more of the equality impact assessments published. So some portfolios have put a good amount of links within their sections. The COVID recovery portfolio, for example, has put multiple links to different equality impact assessments that they have used. And it would be good to see that across all portfolios, so that there's an ease of access to the information and the decision-making analysis that they have taken, and the decisions that they've come to. Without that, there's the question of whether that analysis has taken place. I think it's also another important practical step to be taken, is that the Equalities Budget Advisory Group has made a set of recommendations to government and parliament about how to improve equalities analysis within the budget process, and really moving forward those recommendations, which include things like improving building capacity to deliver the analysis, and really concrete steps like training that could be provided in the regularity of that training, also communications around the analysis work, and clear leadership in order to deliver it. So the Scottish Government has said it will respond to those recommendations in spring 2022. And so really that response is crucial on how we ensure that the analysis going into the budget can then be correctly reflected in the final statements and documentation that comes out.
Thank you, Sarah. Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you. That was really helpful. And actually, the example from the transport portfolio and also the COVID recovery one is really useful for us. So we can look into that in more detail. I think it's really helpful. Almost completely different subject, but obviously still on the budget and still on a feminist analysis of it. In your deliberations and you're looking at what came out, what is your assessment of the impact that we may be able to have on violence against women, and in particular violence against women's services, as part of the response to addressing some of the structural inequalities which of course drive violence against women as well as make it worse?
Sarah Cowan.
I think what's difficult when it comes to tackling violence against women is viewing it as looking at investment on a year-on-year level and what the budget is investing in a year-on-year level. Services that are delivering to support women who've experienced violence and prevention, they need long-term reassurance around funding. And so I suppose it's a bit beyond this budget, but looking more at the resource spending review and giving those services confidence that they will have longer-term funding is going to be a really important element. So the ongoing funding within this budget continues to support services, but we'd really like to see that more long-term funding, because it also, without the long-term funding, it takes time away from delivering services to working out where the next year's funding is coming from as well, and also provides uncertainty to the services, which is not what you want when you're working with such a vulnerable group of people. You want to know that your focus can be on providing the support that's really needed. So it would be a call kind of going forward, really, that I would say is really important to look at, and that's about how we can ensure that long-term support is and confidence is given to these services.
An issue that we plan to return to early in the new year, you'll be comforted to note. Thank you very much indeed for that. I've got a question now from Jeremy Balfour, please.
Thank you again, Convener, and thank you for the answers so far. If I can pick up three questions, and just picking up on that final point that you just made, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance seemed to indicate that we'll be moving to a three-year funding for the third sector. Have you had any indication at a kind of level of what conversations have taken place on that? Have you received any communication from Scottish Government on that? I'm just wondering if it has got down to the level of local groups yet.
Sarah Cowan.
We've not received any communication directly on the announcement that was in the budget, although I do want to recognise that we have recently received a three-year funding from the Scottish Government Equality and Human Rights Fund. So that provides us as a group, and I know many others in the third sector, with that three-year funding within the theme of within the framework of equalities. I think the networking groups like SCVO will probably be first to receive those kind of communications, and then it will come out through those networks to their membership and other community groups. As I was saying in the last answer, related to violence against women services, but more widely for the third sector, kind of the confidence that multi-year funding can provide to provide focus on what you're doing rather than having to focus on where the next funding comes from is really important.
Jeremy Balfour.
Oh, thank you. I'm much helpful. My second question really goes back to previous questions from other panellists. I think we all recognise that there are now a lot more unpaid carers, particularly who are female. Have you any idea of the number of who are out there that we don't know about, which I appreciate sounds contradictory? But secondly, how would you envisage either Scottish Government or this committee could actually find that information out? Because obviously, if we want people to get the appropriate benefits that they are due, how do we identify those individuals? And have you a feeling, are we talking about hundreds of thousands? Are we talking, what scale are we talking about? Have you any concept of that?
Sarah Cowan.
So, Carers Scotland have highlighted the increase in unpaid carers, and I think the numbers go up to now 1.1 million unpaid carers. But when we move down to considering those who are maybe in receipt of carers allowance, the numbers are significantly lower than that, partly because of the tight eligibility around carers allowance. So I think the first step would be if the committee is looking at this further, to reconsider that eligibility to carers allowance and who is eligible. Not necessarily that all unpaid carers would be seeking to access that kind of support, but I think at the moment there's very tight constraints around it, which also causes challenges for unpaid carers who want to be in part-time work and provide care. So that would be the starting point from my point of view, is to consider who's eligible for that sort of support and how that part could be extended. And then, as you say, that knowing about unpaid carers we don't know about is very challenging. But the more that there are local services that are available to provide support to people who are receiving support, as well as those who are providing care, and that people can have confidence in those services, that they will be reliable, that they will provide the support needed, the more that that sort of support is available locally, the more people will come forward to access it. And that will be another way where budget spend can, at the local level, and can support these unpaid carers to reach out for support.
Thank you very much. Jeremy Balfour, do you have a further question, or is that?
Yeah, no, I've got one more question, but can I just follow up that one before I go to my final question? I'm actually, yes. Is it the number of hours that you have to care for somebody that is the biggest hurdle, or what for you is the biggest hurdle that is stopping more people applying for carers allowance?
It's the carers allowance eligibility criteria, so that the criteria around how many hours of part-time work you're able to do while also being able to access the allowance. So I think the hurdle is less about people choosing to apply for the allowance and more about access to it and eligibility to it. So it's a consideration of that. And also ensuring that people know what allowances and extra support is available, especially with the large increase in unpaid carers. There may be people who don't know what is available, so increasing information about what's available will be important too.
Thank you. Jeremy Balfour.
Yeah, and my final question, Sarah, is if you could change the budget in one way to make it better from what you've told us so far, what would be the one change you would make? Where would you move the money around that would make the biggest difference to the people that you're working with?
Derek Cowan.
I think it's more investment in care. So we have seen the discussion around the National Care Service is moving forward, and there is commitment to increasing the spend on social care through the course of this Parliament. I think the faster that can come, the better. So looking at that, and if this relates, ensuring that local government is funded to provide those kind of local services as well. So we know that women are more likely to rely on local services that are delivered by local government. So ensuring that they have the tools to provide those public services where they're needed.
Thank you very much indeed, Sarah. I think that brings to a close the questions from my colleagues. I think that has been an incredibly informative session. I really appreciate your time this morning, Sarah. Thank you very much indeed for spending so much time with us this morning, and wish you a very Merry Christmas and all the best for 2022, when we'll no doubt be back in touch again. That brings to a conclusion the public part of this morning's meeting. The committee will next meet on Thursday, the 13th of January, when we will hear from the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government again on the budget. While I'm moving to suspend the meeting and move to private session, I just want to wish everybody who's been watching a very Merry Christmas. Thank everybody for supporting the committee this year, the clerks, broadcasting, Spice, and all of the people who have come to give evidence. Very much appreciated. Again, wish you all a very Merry Christmas, a safe Christmas, and all the best for 2022. I suspend the meeting, move to private session, and I invite colleagues on the committee to join the private session via the link provided. Thank you very much.